very warm welcome to all our guests as well as audience members who have joined us for this conversation today. My name is Abhishek Shah. I am part of the financial services team at Intellic App, and we are very thrilled to be hosting this session focusing on bridging the financing gap towards growth of women collectives in India. Over the course of the next 90 minutes, we will be discussing ideas around structuring a result-based financing framework for this segment, posing some key nuances in terms of challenge areas that come up in structuring instrument or an intervention such as this. But before we get into that conversation, I would love to introduce our panelists and speakers for today's discussion. Can we go to the next slide, please? Yeah, from the FI community side, joining us on this conversation today, we have Mr. Raman Taneja, who's the Chief Product Officer at Earth Finance. We also have Ms. Rekha Kulkarniji, who's the CEO at Mandeshi Bank, and Ms. Nirmala Vedula, who's the Deputy Vice President at IndusInd Bank. From a service provider's perspective and grassroots organizations who are working with women collectives, we have with us Ms. Kusum Balsara, who's the general manager at Marvin. And we also have Mr. Balakrishnan, who's the CEO at Ruti. And finally, as a great mentor and support to engagements focusing on women, we have Mr. Amit Arora, senior financial sector advisor at World Bank, to guide us through in terms of this conversation and to share perspectives around how World Bank has been intervening in this space over the past few years, as well as going forward. With that being said, I would like to now set to the context for today's conversation. The way we are going to structure this conversation is, over the course of the next 10 minutes, for the benefit of our audience, we will summarize the landscape of women collectives in order to give you a perspective of what is the problem that we are trying to solve, what does the segment look like, and how big an opportunity there is in terms of crowding in commercial capital. Post that brief introductory summarization, I will get into a discussion with our participants here, trying to understand how the financing intervention that we are envisaging, which would take the shape of a result-based support, actually materialize, and what would be the way forward in terms of actually structuring them to ensure that the objectives are met and there is a path to sustainability of the intervention that can allow commercial capital to eventually come in without any assistance from the donor communities. And finally, we will have open up the session for any questions and answers that the audiences may have. While we will have a dedicated conversation with the audiences towards the fag end of the conversation, I would encourage all our esteemed audience members to please feel free to use the chat box to pose any questions for our fellow panelist members that can make the conversation more engaging, as well as allow you to get specific inputs that are of interest to you in the context of this intervention. Some of you may already be working on interventions similar to this in your individual capacities, and therefore, please also feel free to share any perspectives that you have other than questions for our participants that would enlighten all of us in this journey. With that being said, I would like to quickly start and take you through the overall landscape. You know, the segment that we are looking to address or intervene in is the women collective space, which essentially means that we are trying to support women who come together as a group and run an enterprise or a business activity as a group. Now, in order to understand this segment, you'd essentially find that women in groups can either be part of formal structures or informal structures. And the vast majority of them would probably come under the informal structures where they are formed into SHG groups primarily with the objective of mobilizing savings and doing intra-group credit. But eventually these groups also tend to get into some form of economic activity, either in individual capacities or jointly with the same group members, or they tend to hive out from these groups and create separate producer groups that are engaged in that common activity. We also have dedicated programs that have been run by the government under which some of these women have been incubated and assisted in starting enterprise activities. Specifically, one such program was a Startup Village Entrepreneurship Program, under which close to 1.5 lakh enterprises were set up or incubated and involved close to 8 to 12 lakh women. Together, this informal segment comprises about 70 to 80 lakh women who are associated in the group-based activity space. When we look at the formal structure side, we have the producer companies and cooperatives. A vast majority of them are into farm-based activities. And it's often very difficult to distinguish whether these are over and above the informal groups or these are some common members from the SHG groups who have now been federated under formal structures of either producer companies or cooperatives, depending on the interventions that have been followed at a state level or through central agencies that are working with them. The kind of activities that these women are part of are also quite heterogeneous, varying from state to state and even within state. Unlike in many of the MSME clusters where you have a group of enterprises in a particular geographic area performing similar activities, that level of clusterization in the non-farm space has been limited basis whatever findings we could get from the ground and the existing surveys. But the idea essentially is to look at the women who are working in this space and understand their business diagnostics as well as understand their credit requirements that go unmet. And from that perspective, you'd notice that mostly in the informal space, you'd find women who are doing revenues anywhere between 1 lakh to 5 lakh rupees, either individually or as a group, making a profit about 25 to 50% on the net revenues that they make through the business. And the typical credit requirements that remain unmet are anywhere between 50,000 to 15 lakh rupees. Likewise, on the formal side, we have ticket sizes or the revenue sizes starting from 5 lakh going upwards. There is 50 lakh, 60 lakh. Some cooperatives are also into crores. But if you look at the larger chunk of these formal groups, most of them would form in the 5 to 20 lakh revenue buckets. The profit margins are slightly lower, obviously, because of the higher scale. And the average credit requirements, while 3 to 10 lakh is what is indicated here, obviously for some of the larger cooperatives, it could also go up into crores. But what we've tried to grab here is the larger chunk where we've noticed entities in the non-farm space and the kind of ticket sizes that they have sought for. Yeah, next slide, please. Now, the idea was to look at this segment very closely, understand what are the challenges that one, these enterprises are facing, and two, the FIs are facing in servicing this segment. And in that context, we had convened a similar group about a few weeks back, 6 to 8 weeks back, to understand these issues more in depth. And that's where our key understandings are that on the demand side, there are three primary issues that are constraining these collective groups from scaling their businesses beyond livelihood or subsistence level to enterprises of scale that can sort of motivate other women groups or members to look up and take up entrepreneurship as a full-time activity rather than simply a livelihood activity. And these three challenges are, number one, limited business understanding, be it around market linkage, be it around branding, packaging, etc. A limited level of formalization with respect to either bookkeeping or documentation requirements that would allow them to access formal markets, even to the extent of pivoting into an online sales model or using online aggregation platforms. There are issues around documentation that seem to crop up very frequently, and therefore that is one key structural limitation that is inhibiting a lot of these enterprises. And finally, most of these enterprises have been relying either on the SHG structures or the CLF funds or the government funds for their business activities, which are usually very small in terms of ticket sizes, ranging anywhere between 10 to 30,000 on a per woman basis or up to 1 lakh rupees at a group level in most cases. And therefore, if there is any requirement for larger ticket loan sizes or loan sizes of longer term, longer duration, for instance, machinery purchase that we were discussing a little while back before the session started, that's often an area where the needs are usually unmet. Most of the financing that is being directed right now is coming from internal government sources, or a part of it is coming from the bank linkage program. But there is a dearth of products that are structured to create, to meet these long-term requirements or for the purpose of CAPEX needs. And that's where we'll seek some inputs from our guests here on the FI side to see how best these needs could be serviced. Our conversations with the supply side, on the other hand, indicate three very persisting challenges in serving this segment. Number one being, considering that they are so scattered and dispersed, as well as there's no proper database to understand their activities or identify their geographic locations, the cost of servicing them for small ticket requirements turns out to be quite high. And therefore, there's often a need for some form of subvention to come in to be able to support this segment at rates that they can absorb. The second issue, pressing issue, is given the dearth of formalization and lack of documentation, any form of credit assessment becomes very difficult in this segment. And therefore, there's a pressing need for either some form of external risk mitigation to come in or some other measures, institutional measures to be created that allows these bankers or FIs to assess the credit risk more appropriately. And the final point that emerges from these conversations is that just meeting the capacity building needs may not be enough, or just meeting the credit needs may not be enough, as most of them require handholding support beyond credit need to utilization of those credit proceeds as well. And therefore, a bundled solution is what is required, but FIs are not equipped to offer these bundled solutions or non-financing support that is needed in this sector. I'll take a pause here. If you can go back to the previous slide, I'll take a pause here and come to Bala first. Bala, from your experiences, does this capture, considering that you've been working so closely with women groups in terms of helping them, on the capacity building side, as well as understanding their issues right from a formation stage to the time that they get into mainstream activity and try and scale. And you've also been trying to link them with some form of capital access. From your experiences, does this summarize the existing landscape? If you could share a few opening remarks from your perspective and experiences, that would be wonderful.
Yeah, thank you, Abhishek. I think, thank you so much, first of all, having me here and to share our experience. I think overall, I think it's well captured on the demand side challenges and also supply chain challenges. One I see is about, I think what you have captured here, it is absolutely right. But how are we going to execute or address these challenges is going to be very, very important. As a kind of implementing and then also as a technical support organization with various organizations, we found the challenges when we have to deliver these the supply chain challenges related to high cost or the need of bundle of services to doorstep needs to be delivered. Yeah, which how as a, each of the organization, implementing organization, are we ready to change? And also looking at these initiatives not as a project, because most of the initiative which we look at is a project, because these are all enterprises or institutions required continuous support, and there is a change required during the journey. And how well the organization which is implementing and supporting them and willing to pivot during the journey and continuously willing to support. If that is not there, as we are seeing today in the producer collectives in the country, which has been through various schemes which we have promoted, but most like 50% of them actually now idle or it has been closed. Yeah, I think we experience most of the programs which we have seen, SSG Federation, if there is a continuity is not kept and during the journey, and we need to be keep changing to the environment needs and the what is expected from the market side, if we are not changing, we will become redundant, and each of the enterprise or collective will become, it will be died. That's the experience which we are having. That's where we, as an organization, we look at it, how do we make people professional partnership and collectives lifelong, which that's how we believe in, because we are not creating a dependency. I think, how do we create a mechanism in which we are supporting them? And there is a sustainable model we look at in this journey. That's what I can say at this point in time.
Sure. Thanks for that opening remarks, Bala. Kusumji, let me come to you. As one of the preeminent organizations which has been working with a lot of women groups in Maharashtra, and not just working with them, but working over a period of time with the groups to ensure that they migrate from the basic understanding of SHG processes to eventually running their own enterprises successfully. And then also enabling credit access, most importantly, in partnership with banks in Maharashtra. What has been your experience? And you know, the overall objective in a way has always been to allow these women collectives to grow, or in terms of, you know, access scale, in terms of growth in revenues. So basis your experience of working with these collectives over the last 10 years or more, have you actually been able to demonstrate that access to credit has played an important role in the growth of their businesses, in the growth of their revenues, or the growth of their economic empowerment in the society? If you could share some perspectives of, you know, how you've been able to achieve that, and what is the on-ground proof of the pudding that you've been able to establish with your continued and dedicated work, that will sort of open up this discussion very nicely for the rest of us.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot. Basically, I'm audible now. Hello?
Yes, Kusumji, we can hear you.
Yeah. So I'm very happy to be part of this session. Basically, I feel that when you are working in isolations, we feel that these are the issues and challenges which we are facing. But when we heard from the so many partners who are working on the worldwide, and they are also expressing such kind of challenges, we feel very much joint and share vision and share the pain also. Okay, this is something we are trying too hard to pursue the things, and these challenges are not really heard by the policymakers. So it gives you pain. So such kind of forums can really make it as an can contribute to the policy, and that is something I feel it is very much important area where this kind of forum can really take it to the next level. As you said, in Mavin, what we have done into the last I'm not comfortable with this, I'll just make it So in Mavin, what we have done,
and your audio is, Kusumji, your audio is now not clear, at least at my
end. Not clear. So then I'll have to use the mic. Okay.
Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you.
You can, yeah. So basically what I was thinking, the way you have captured the challenges, it is absolutely, we are agreeing with that, and these are the challenges we are facing. Mavim is working in 3 decades into the SAG, and we have transformed SAG, and whatever the, we have built the confidence, asked them to take a loans. The women who were not in a position and confident to take a loan of rupees, 100 rupees and 1,000 rupees, now they have graduated and they are able to and absorb the loans of 1 lakh rupees as a individual loans. Still our SAGs has been financed only as per the total average loan size. If you see for the SAG, in Maharashtra, with the lots of efforts, with Mavi message, it is coming around 2.25 lakhs per average SAG now. Whereas one woman is has a capacity, not every woman, if there is a 12 women in one SAG, so at least 3 women, 4 women have a capacity to absorb the loan of 1 lakh to 5 lakhs, and even few women can 25%. 5-10% women can absorb the loans of 10 lakhs also, 7 to 10 lakhs. That is what our status says. But still the such kind of products are not available. The ticket size which is required is not available. The aspirations level has gone so much, and we have given so much confidence to them, and we have builded so many support systems to them. Mandeshi is here, even Mandeshi is also will agree with me, ki so much amount of efforts has gone into the capacity building and building their enterprises. And now what happens, you know, even we are working on the end-to-end supply chains, trying to make them as a part of access to the, make them part of the supply chain, value chains. So definitely the ticket size of loan is very, very small. And still bankers now don't have confidence and comfort to address them as an individual loan or ME loan, micro enterprise loan. Still, they are very much comfortable with the format of SHG, and that is the biggest challenge I could see. So the every woman, for example, we are working with 17 lakhs families. So I have a individual women's profile. Every woman I can and my bankers, because we are working through the partnerships with various bankers, and every individual's profile with us within the SHG, how much loan she has taken, how she has repaid, the whole credit history is available with us. And still people says, you know, when the format of SHG is not there, we are not uncomfortable to give the loans, because they really see the default may increase. And I'm not blaming them, because in some part of country, we have seen such examples also. The moment you go on to the individual loans, and default rate goes up. But now what we, as you have rightly captured the things, ki, with the support systems, with the absolute training and capacity building, it is possible for them to really transform into the enterprises, and very nice and profitable enterprises they can manage. Basically, we should believe their abilities. That is something I always feel. And when it comes to the women, it is always doubted her ability and her, that is the, as Women's Development Corporation, we have seen that, ki, whenever places she has goes, if even post-harvest places, she is absolutely no, she is not there. So wherever is the drudgery, wherever she is working as a bag rope, it is okay. But when she goes into a post-harvest, the even societal norms also not allowing and believing her abilities. That is my another lens I would like to contribute here. And therefore, and she is not a farmer again, because the whole land is not on her name. So she is not considered as a farmer. So all those questions and issues are limiting their access to finance. And that is something we have to really aggressively work on that. And that is what, and whatever you have captured the issues that are very, very relevant, and we need to address and to build a comfort of a banking system. I think there is a need to have some mitigation, risk mitigation provisions, FLD type of first loan default guarantee type of arrangements has to be there, so that bank can really build their confidence. It might be a stopgap arrangement. I'm not saying it should be the long time the arrangement. It might be a stopgap arrangement. As SHG, when we have built, that time even SHG bankers were not believing them. But now every bank is very comfortable with SHG. The such a way, we have to really build the confidence of bankers also to service them. And as sir was saying, Balakrishnan, ki basically the doorstep service, hassle-free service, timely loans, these are the main issues which has been addressed by the micro SHG movement. And Mavim has really worked on upon very, very heavily. And therefore, we found very successful models could help, demonstrated, and sustainable development we could really pursue through that. So I feel these are the issues which has to be very pertinent, and we have to address it. For a moment, I'll take a pause over here, Abhishek. Thank you.
Sure, Kusubji, thank you very much. Ek bahut hi ahem mudda jis pe main ek quick comment lena chahunga aapse aur fir Rekha ji se as a financial institution. And ye mudda important hai, because aage jaake hum dekhenge jab hum solution build kar rahe hain, to wo ek bahut ahem kadi hogi hamare is pure conversation ki. Wo ye samajhna hai कि जब हम इन महिलाओं को सपोर्ट करते हैं, समझ लीजिए आज के दिन में हम इनको एक लाख रुपए के लोन के माध्यम से इनको हम उत्साहित करते हैं या प्रोत्साहित करते हैं कि वो अपने धंधे के विकास में ध्यान दे. इस एक लाख के लोन के वजह से क्या हमारे एक्सपीरियंसेस में, जब आपने कुसुम जी काम किया या रेखा जी जब आपके बैंक ने इन महिलाओं को सपोर्ट किया, क्या आपको वो रेवेन्यू इंक्रीज में ट्रांसलेट होता हुआ दिखाई दिया है? और अगर दिया है तो वो लोन और उसके बीच में रेवेन्यू इंक्रीज इस दौरान कितने समय का वक्त निकल जाता है टू सी दैट इफेक्ट कम ऑन द ग्राउंड? यू नो कि आज एक लाख का लोन मिला तो साल भर बाद वो रेवेन्यू इंक्रीज में ट्रांसलेट होता है, दो साल बाद होता है, कई केसेस में नहीं भी होता होगा. कई बार ऋण हमें चाहिए ताकि हम अपने लेवल पे जो बिजनेस कर रहे हैं उस लेवल पे मैनेज कर सके या बिजनेस के सर्वाइवल को प्रोटेक्ट कर सके, और कई बार वो ऋण हमें अपने बिजनेस को एक्सपैंड करने में भी मदद करता है. जस्ट ये समझना कि बिजनेस एक्सपेंशन कितने केसेस में होता है ऋण की मदौलत से और वो कितने दिनों बाद ट्रांसलेट करता है बिजनेस की बढ़ोतरी में, इस पर अगर आपकी कोई प्रतिक्रिया होगी तो वो बहुत अहम होगी इस कॉन्वर्सेशन के लिए।
रेखा जी आप बोल रहे हैं या?
तो अभिषेक जी नमस्ते। तो मुझे यहाँ ये करना है कि आपने जैसे बोला कि 1 लाख लोन देने के बाद कितने दिन में उनको मुनाफा स्टार्ट होता है, एक तो उनके हाथ में पैसे आ जाए तो तुरंत वो कुछ खरीदारी वगैरह कर सकती है, तो एटलीस्ट उसको बिजनेस सेटअप करने के लिए 3 से 6 महीने लग जाते हैं, उसके बाद उसके हाथ में इनकम आना स्टार्ट होता है। लेकिन यहाँ मैं बोलना चाहती हूँ कि हमारा ज्यादा इसमें लोन इसमें इंडिविजुअल फोकस ज्यादा है, ना कि ग्रुप लोन्स या ऐसे। तो मुझे कहीं ना कहीं लगता है कि जो महिलाएं खुद काम कर रही है, उनके साथ 5-6 महिलाएं काम कर रही है, तो वो उसका बिजनेस ज्यादा फास्टली ग्रो होता है। तो जैसे अमित जी ने भी स्टार्टिंग में बताया कि हमने एक प्रोडक्ट के लिए साथ में काम किए थे, तो उसमें भी हमें 1 साल में उस प्रोडक्ट का हमने इम्पैक्ट देखा। तो बिजनेस कैसे कर रही है, उसका पहले छोटा सा बिजनेस था, तो उसके साथ में उस अभी समझिए ओनियन पोटैटो बेच रही है बिजनेस फील्ड में जाके वीकली मार्केट में, तो साथ साथ में उसने वेजिटेबल्स के आइटम्स बढ़ाए हैं, तो उसका वो बिजनेस एक्सपांड हुआ है। तो 6 से 9 महीने तक उसको इनकम का ऑटोमेटिकली उसका ग्रोथ हो जाता है, ये हमारे एक्सपीरियंस से दिख जाता है।
I agree with Rekha ji and I would have a little different point is that it depends on the what activity she is doing. If she is doing catering, for example, अगर वड़ा पाव का गाड़ी उसने डाला तो सुबह इन्वेस्टमेंट किया शाम को पैसा हाथ में आया, सो दैट इज नॉट समथिंग इट इज समथिंग देर इज नो टाइम एंड इज देयर, बट नाउ वॉट एंड इनकम जनरेशन एक्टिविटीज विच वी हैव बीन इम्प्लीमेंटेड सिंस लास्ट 2 decades. We found out the activities not enterprises, they were income generation activities. So the investment into the income generation activities were very, very small. And therefore, the gaining out of it was also very, the tenure was very, very small. It is on a very long term. But when we are trying to translate into the enterprises when it grows to the enterprise level, so definitely the investment will be higher. So for example, my woman is rearing the goat of 5+1 buck, I mean 6 things. So she is investing around 2 lakhs, 2.5 lakhs. But at that point of time, the moment we say the goat is an ATM, you know, any time they can take money from, whenever they want to any emergency, they can sell out their goat and they can bring the money. So such kind of things, it is not really, the waiting period is very, very small. But when she going into the goat farm, the altogether the same activity, but when she is doing as an income generation activity and when she is doing as an enterprise, the whole scenario and management skills, the moratorium period, everything really changes. And therefore, organizations like us, we are also in a process to understand ki how that particular break-even can be very small and shorter time so that she builds the confidence of her. So that is something. For example, we had a partnership with Lucius and we had a very good quality goat. But when Lucius will purchase the goats, I mean such kind of brands, as we think once we have an aggregation and we identified the market player such like Lucius, we don't get the good price. You know, my women were saying, ma'am, we can get a very good domestic price is more than the Lucius, you know. But the continuous supply is something the issue. And we are good price, continuous sustainable price and break even. So there are some issues with change from commodity to commodity also. So cannot have the very thumb rule, but these are the some of my experiences over there. But at least whatever the agri businesses we are investing, in that definitely you have to have the break even within the 6 months and processing unit. You can have the break even 6 months, 8 months, 10 months. But the investment is bigger. For example, we have started the processing of Khawa unit. The Khawa unit is not given the break even in the even 1 year. It goes up to 2 years also. So it depends on the activity. That is what precisely I want to make a point.
थैंक यू कुसुम
अभिषेक जी. मैं कुसुम जी का ही जो अभी उन्होंने गोट का एक्सपीरियंस शेयर किया ना, तो हम मैं यहाँ थोड़ा बोलना चाहती हूँ कि हम भी ना हम ऐसे हमारे इसमें स्ट्रक्चर में हमने ये किया है, हम चिकन्स को लोन देते हैं महिलाओं के लिए लेकिन पोल्ट्री फार्म को नहीं देते हैं. हम भैंसों के लिए देते हैं, डेयरी के लिए नहीं देते हैं. क्योंकि क्या होता है, जब बिजनेस बड़े हो जाते हैं तो ऑटोमेटिकली वो बिजनेस महिलाओं के हाथ से निकल के मेन के हाथ में चला जाता है. और जब तक वो महिलाओं के हाथ में बिजनेस है तब तक वो अच्छी तरह से उसको कंट्रोल कर सकती है, वो कर सकती है. एक बार मेल के हाथ में बिजनेस गया तो उसके हाथ से वो कंट्रोल निकल जाता है. तो जैसे अभी इन्होंने कुसुम जी ने गोट का एग्जाम्पल बताया ना, तो हमारा एक गोट के ऊपर ही प्रोजेक्ट है मानदेशी फाउंडेशन में, जो हमारे गोट डॉक्टर्स है जो फील्ड में जाके गोट को आर्टिफिशियल इंसिमिनेशन करके जो महिलाएं एक दो जो गोट्स घर में पालती है तो उनका ऑटोमेटिकली, जैसे अभी वो हमारी महिलाएं बोलती है कि हमारा ये गोट है तो हमारा ये एटीएम है, तो हम जाके वो कभी भी बेच सकते हैं. तो तुरंत हमें जैसे गोल्ड भी होता है तो महिलाओं को एक वो अलग सा कॉन्फिडेंस रहता है कि गोल्ड, यदि बैंक भी बंद है तभी भी गोल्ड स्मिथ के जाके हम वो गोल्ड रख के उसके ऊपर लोन ले सकते हैं. तो गोल्ड हो, गोट हो, ये सब चीजें हमारी महिलाओं को एक तरह का वो एटीएम बोलती है इसके लिए.
करेक्ट, धन्यवाद इन प्रतिक्रियाओं के लिए रेखा जी एंड कुसुम जी, अप्रिशिएट दैट. इस कॉन्वर्सेशन को आगे बढ़ाते हैं, फैसिलिटी की तरफ मूव करते हैं. बट उससे पहले बहुत ब्रीफली फॉर द बेनिफिट ऑफ ऑडियंस अगेन, थोड़े अंडरलाइन कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स और सेगमेंटेशन इस पूरे लैंडस्केप का एक बार देखने की कोशिश करते हैं ताकि वो कॉन्वर्सेशन को बेटर कॉन्टेक्स्ट रहे. कैन आई रिक्वेस्ट फॉर द नेक्स्ट स्लाइड प्लीज. हमने ब्रॉडली इस पूरे सेगमेंट को जब स्टडी किया अक्रॉस मल्टीपल स्टेट्स, तो हमें तीन भिन्न प्रकार की एंटरप्राइजेस नजर में आए जिनको अलग किस्म की सपोर्ट चाहिए इंक्रीमेंटली. पहली है उस तरह की महिलाएं या उस तरह के ग्रुप्स जहां पे बिजनेस एक्टिविटी चल रही है, उनको अपने काम के बारे में पता है, उनकी जो एक बेसिक नीड है वो अब कि उनको एक क्रेडिट प्रोडक्ट दिया जाए जो उनके एग्जिस्टिंग अवेलेबल प्रोडक्ट से थोड़े हायर टिकट साइज का हो, जिससे वो अब अपने रिक्वायरमेंट, चाहे वो इंक्रीज वर्किंग कैपिटल के लिए हो, चाहे वो कोई स्पेसिफिक मशीनरी में इन्वेस्ट करने के लिए हो ताकि उनके प्रोडक्ट की क्वालिटी इंप्रूव हो सके, या जो मैनुअल प्रोसेसेस थे वो मैकेनाइज हो सके ताकि वो कॉस्ट लेवल पे मार्केट पे बेटर कम्पीट कर सके. इन आवश्यकताओं के लिए उनको पता है उनको काम कैसे करना है, वो काम अपना करना जानती है. ऑल दैट दे नीड इज कि एक इंक्रीज टिकट साइज की प्रोडक्ट उनको मिले. इस तरह के एक्टिविटीज हम देखते हैं कि लगभग से लगभग कम से कम पूरे देश भर में हमारे एस्टिमेट्स के हिसाब से 4-7 लाख इस तरह के एंटरप्राइजेस हैं जिनको इस तरह की क्रेडिट नीड्स है, जहां पे उनको कोई कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग सपोर्ट नहीं चाहिए बल्कि एक 50,000 से 3 लाख तक का लोन चाहिए. और इस पूरे अपॉर्चुनिटी को देखें तो हमें हमारे हिसाब से FIs के लिए दिस इज रफली अबाउट 7-10,000 crore वर्थ ऑफ अपॉर्चुनिटी इन दिस सेगमेंट, वेयर ओनली कैपिटल इज द की इम्पेडिमेंट. A lot of these needs are exacerbated because of the COVID, and therefore, how do we ensure that these women get access to the required credit is the point of contention around which we've been trying to develop a solution. Next slide, please. The next key intervention or the next key focus area in this segment is incremental. Jahan pe it's not just about access to loans, but capacity building is a very important component. Kyunki वो जो एक्टिविटीज कर रही हैं वो एक्टिविटीज सस्टेन नहीं हो पा रही, जैसा कि बालाजी ने बोला स्टार्टिंग में, यू नो ऑलमोस्ट 50% ऑफ द एंटरप्राइजेस दैट वर क्रिएटेड सपोर्टेड हैव नाउ नॉट बीन एबल टू सस्टेन देमसेल्व्स और हैव फोल्डेड अप. एंड दैट्स अ वेरी डोमिनेंट प्रॉब्लम इस सेगमेंट में, जहां में हम ये नजर आ रहा है दैट कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट कॉम्पोनेंट. एंड इस कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग के कई मायने हैं, इट्स नॉट जस्ट अबाउट मार्केट लिंकेज, बट उससे भी बहुत पहले से शुरू होती हैं ये नीड्स. And वो needs को identify करके वो support उनको provide करना along with necessary capital so that दे कैन देन एम्बार्क ऑन अ ग्रोथ जर्नी. इस तरह के अगर हम एंटरप्राइजेस को देखें तो हमारे हिसाब से दिस इज रफली अगेन अबाउट 75,000 से 2,00,000 इस तरह के एंटिटीज हैं, और यहाँ पे इस सेगमेंट में लगभग 5,000 से 8,000 करोड़ की क्रेडिट अपॉर्चुनिटी दिखाई देती है अक्रॉस इंडिया लेवल पे, जहाँ पे ऑन एन एवरेज एंटरप्राइजेस को 3 से 10 लाख रुपए की लोन की आवश्यकता है. बट सिर्फ लोन से ये काम नहीं चलेगा, उनको इसके साथ साथ कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग सपोर्ट विच इज प्री डिस्बर्सल सपोर्ट एज वेल एज पोस्ट डिस्बर्सल हैंड होल्डिंग इन टर्म्स ऑफ यूटिलाइजेशन ऑफ द प्रोसीड्स इज ऑल्सो वेरी क्रिटिकल. एंड द थर्ड सेगमेंट इफ यू लुक एट इज एसेंशली जहाँ पे हमने आइडेंटिफाई किया कि वुमेन महिलाएं काफी प्रतिभाशाली हैं या फिर वो ऑलरेडी लाइवलीहुड एक्टिविटीज कर रही हैं लेकिन फार्म सेगमेंट में कर रही हैं. अभी उनको फार्म सेगमेंट में जो कैश फ्लोज हैं वो काफी अनप्रडिक्टेबल हैं, फ्लक्चुएट करते हैं, सीजनल रहते हैं. देयरफॉर दे वांट टू ऑगमेंट इट विद सम एक्टिविटी ऑन द नॉन फार्म साइड, लेकिन उनको समझ नहीं आ रहा कि किस एक्टिविटी में उनको जाना चाहिए, कहाँ पे वो कंप्लीट कर पाएंगे. सो एसेंशियली इस सेगमेंट में कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग से पहले जो एक स्टेप आता है वो है क्रिएशन ऑफ एन इकोसिस्टम एंड अ प्रोजेक्ट. किसी पर्टिकुलर स्टेट में वो कौन से वैल्यू चेन्स हैं जहाँ पे पोटेंशियल है, कहाँ पे किस तरह के इननेट स्किल रिक्वायरमेंट्स को हम प्रोत्साहित कर सकते हैं, उसको आइडेंटिफाई करना, फिर उस तरह की एक्टिविटी को प्रमोट करने के लिए सिर्फ अगर कोई हैंडीक्राफ्ट बना रही है, टेक्सटाइल्स में है, तो सिर्फ वो टेक्सटाइल में स्टिचिंग का काम का अगर हम एंटरप्राइज या कलेक्टिव को सपोर्ट करें तो शायद वो काफ़ी नहीं होगा. उसके साथ साथ हमें वो स्टिचिंग के लिए जो पर्टिकुलर तरह की यार्न्स की रिक्वायरमेंट है वो उनको किस तरह से सही टाइम पे सही कॉस्ट में मिल सके छोटे छोटे क्वांटिटीज में, उसके साथ साथ वो स्टिचिंग के डिजाइंस किस तरह के होने चाहिए, वो डिजाइन सप्लायर कोई है क्या, उसी के साथ साथ उसकी पैकेजिंग कैसी होनी चाहिए फाइनल प्रोडक्ट की. अगर हम बेडशीट बना रहे हैं उसको मार्केट तक लेके जाने के लिए अगर हम डायरेक्ट B2C सेल कर रहे हैं तो किस तरह की पैकेजिंग B2C मार्केट में मेरे को हायर रेवेन्यूज देगी कंपेयर टू अगर मैं B2B कर रही हूँ तो मुझे किस तरह की इंश्योर करनी चाहिए ताकि मैं कॉस्ट को कम करके रखूँ और जो मेरा बायर है वो अल्टीमेटली उसको पैकेज करके सेल कर सके. तो इस तरह की एक्टिविटीज को आइडेंटिफाई करना एट अ ज्योग्राफी लेवल एंड देन उन एंटरप्राइजेस को अलॉन्ग द वैल्यू चेन सीड करना और उस सीड के लिए वो सीड कैपिटल तैयार करना. सो फॉर इंस्टेंस आप महिलाओं को इंक्यूबेट करते हो अक्रॉस 3 पार्ट्स ऑफ द वैल्यू चेन. महिलाएं अपनी तरफ से कुछ अपनी सेविंग्स लाती हैं, जैसे वो 20% ऑफ द सेविंग्स ला रही हैं उस बिजनेस को शुरू करने के लिए जिसके लिए 2,00,000 या 3,00,000 या 5,00,000 रुपए की आवश्यकता है. महिलाओं ने अपनी तरफ से 10 महिलाओं ने मिलकर अपनी तरफ से 50,000 या 1,00,000 रुपए रखे हैं. अभी उनको इंक्रीमेंटली 2 से 3 लाख रुपए चाहिए उस पूरे बिजनेस को अपने उस पर्टिकुलर वैल्यू चेन में स्टार्ट करने के लिए. तो वो सीड कैपिटल, वो प्रोजेक्ट कॉस्ट कैपिटल जो बैंकर से अरेंज करना, वो भी एक क्रिटिकल रिक्वायरमेंट फिर इस सेगमेंट में निकल के आता है. एंड हियर वी बिलीव दैट द अपॉर्चुनिटी इज रफली अबाउट 3,000 to 5,000 crores. हैविंग लुक्ड एट दीज 3 key models और 3 key types ऑफ सपोर्ट इंटरवेंशंस रिक्वायर्ड, ओनली क्रेडिट, क्रेडिट प्लस कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग, क्रेडिट प्लस कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग प्लस इकोसिस्टम डेवलपमेंट, वी सेट आउट इन टर्म्स ऑफ अंडरस्टैंडिंग व्हाट कुड बी द पोटेंशियल स्ट्रक्चर्स थ्रू व्हिच हम इस तरह के रिक्वायरमेंट्स को मीट कर सके. हमने आफ्टर डेलिब्रेशंस विद एक्सपर्ट्स एंड स्टेक होल्डर्स लाइक यू वी अराइव्ड एट अ रिजल्ट बेस्ड फाइनेंसिंग फ्रेमवर्क, जहाँ पे द आइडिया वॉज कि हम एक सर्विस प्रोवाइडर एंटिटी जो इन महिलाओं और इन ग्रुप्स के साथ ग्राउंड लेवल पे काम करती हैं, उनको तैयार करती हैं, उनके साथ काम करेंगे. हम कुछ फॉरवर्ड लुकिंग FIs जो इस सेगमेंट में और महिलाओं को सपोर्ट करना चाहती हैं और यहाँ पे एक बिजनेस केस को भी देख पा रही हैं उनको आइडेंटिफाई करेंगे और बेनिफिशियरी वुमेन को सपोर्ट करने के लिए इन एंटिटीज के मदद से हम उनको कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग एज वेल एज क्रेडिट पहुँचाएंगे. जो आप अपनी स्क्रीन पे अभी देख रहे हैं दैट्स अ वेरी बेसिक सिंप्लीफाइड स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ हाउ अ रिजल्ट बेस्ड फ्रेमवर्क कुड पोटेंशियली वर्क इन दिस सेगमेंट. एंड बहुत कम ऐसे एग्जांपल्स आपको रियल लाइफ में मिलेंगे जिसके बेसिस पे आप इन स्ट्रक्चर्स को इवैल्यूएट कर सके, क्योंकि आज तक जितने रिजल्ट बेस्ड फाइनेंसिंग होते हैं वो या तो आउटकम बेस्ड एड की स्ट्रक्चर्स लेते हैं या फिर वो एक होलसेल लोन्स होते हैं जहाँ पे सर्विस प्रोवाइडर को लोन दिया जाता है ताकि वो फिर एंड यूजर को सर्विसेज डिलीवर कर सके. बट यहाँ पे सर्विस प्रोवाइडर को लोन की बात नहीं है, यहाँ पे सर्विस प्रोवाइडर बेनिफिशियरी एंटरप्राइजेस को केटर करेंगे कि कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग के लिए एंड फिर वो लोन जो है वो FIs इन बेनिफिशियरीज को सप्लाई करेंगे. देयरफॉर दिस इज वेयर द डिस्टिंक्शन कम्स इन, जहाँ पे हमारे पास बहुत लिमिटेड यूज केसेस हैं टू गो बाय एंड देयरफॉर वी बिलीव दैट दिस इज वन ऑफ इट्स ओन काइंड एंड अ पायनियरिंग इनिशिएटिव जहाँ इन महिलाओं को हम किसी रिजल्ट बेस्ड स्ट्रक्चर से सपोर्ट करने की कोशिश करें. अब यहाँ पे रिजल्ट बेस्ड फाइनेंसिंग का तात्पर्य क्या है और व्हाट डू वी रियली मीन एंड वेयर डज दैट स्ट्रक्चर कम इनटू प्ले. एसेंशियली यहाँ पे अगर आप देख रहे हैं सर्विस प्रोवाइडर के 2 बहुत ही इंपॉर्टेंट रोल्स हैं. पहला रोल है कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग सपोर्ट, एंड ये कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग सपोर्ट दो स्टेजेस में आता है. स्टेज वन इज बिफोर एन एफआई इज लेंडिंग टू दिस बेनिफिशियरी. किसी बैंक को या किसी एनबीएफसी को इस सेगमेंट को लेंड करने के लिए कुछ बेसिक जरूरतें हो सकती हैं. क्या इन महिलाओं के पास वो नेसेसरी कागजात हैं जिसके बेसिस पे वो ये लोन्स अवेल कर सके? अगर नहीं है तो सर्विस प्रोवाइडर नीड्स टू स्टेप इन एंड हेल्प देम फॉर्मलाइज. कैन यू गो टू द प्रीवियस स्लाइड प्लीज. दूसरी इंपॉर्टेंट फंक्शन जो सर्विस प्रोवाइडर प्ले कर रहे हैं वो है कि वंस दीज नीड्स हैव बीन आइडेंटिफाइड एंड सर्विस प्रोवाइडर ब्रिंग्स द कैपेसिटी बिल्डर ब्रिंग्स दीज बेनिफिशियरीज इनटू एलिजिबल कैटेगरी, ये नीड्स फाइनेंशियल इंस्टीट्यूशंस को प्रोवाइड करना. क्योंकि जैसा कि हमने देखा था चैलेंजेस में एफआईज के लिए सबसे बड़ी मुसीबत ये थी कि हम कैसे आइडेंटिफाई करें ये एंटरप्राइज कहाँ है, कौन है और कौन लेंडेबल है. उससे भी बड़ी क्योंकि इनके पास ना कोई कागजात है ना कोई फॉर्मल प्रायर बिजनेस हिस्ट्री है, तो हम क्रेडिट असेसमेंट करेंगे तो कैसे करेंगे. देयरफॉर सम लेवल ऑफ ऑथेंटिकेशन दैट नीड्स टू कम इन फ्रॉम द सर्विस प्रोवाइडर और ग्रास रूट ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस जो इन महिलाओं के साथ जुड़े हुए हैं, काम कर रहे हैं और जानते हैं इन महिलाओं को, उनकी वो लीड्स और उस लीड्स के साथ क्या कोई रिस्क मिटिगेशन प्रोडक्ट भी वो ऑफर कर सकते हैं जिसके बेसिस पे एफआईज को कॉन्फिडेंस रहे कि हाँ ये लीड्स हैं, ये लीड्स कुछ इसी तरह से लीड्स नहीं दी हुई हैं, इसके अगेंस्ट में एक स्किन इन द गेम है सर्विस प्रोवाइडर का भी कि अगर ये लीड्स नॉन रीपेबल निकलते हैं तो देयर इज सम रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी दैट द सर्विस प्रोवाइडर इज ऑल्सो ओनिंग फॉर द पर्पस ऑफ सपोर्टिंग दिस सेगमेंट. नाउ इन सब के बाद जो फाइनेंशियल इंस्टीट्यूशन है उसका रोल क्या होता है? उसका रोल है इस सेगमेंट को लेंड करना, एंड लेंड करना एट अ रेट जो वो सेगमेंट अब्सॉर्ब कर सके. 20-22% की लोन्स हर टाइम पे हर तरह की वुमेन कलेक्टिव्स या वुमेन एंटरप्राइजेस नहीं सपोर्ट कर पाए. जब आप जितने छोटे होते हो अपने बिजनेस में तब आप शायद आपके मार्जिन उतने ज्यादा होते हैं, आप उतने ज्यादा रेट्स के लोन्स को अब्सॉर्ब कर सकते हैं, एंड देयरफॉर एमएफआई लोन्स वर्क एट दीज इंटरेस्ट रेट्स बिकॉज वहां पे आपकी कैश साइकिल, आपका रिटर्न ऑन इन्वेस्टमेंट ऑन अ डेली बेसिस जनरेट हो रहा है. जैसा कि कुसुम जी ने बताया कि सुबह अगर मैं किसी केटरिंग बिजनेस को, वड़ा पाव वाले को लोन देती हूँ, मैं उसे 1,000 रुपए सुबह देती हूँ, वो दिन भर में अगर 1,500 रुपए का माल बेच लेता है और 500 रुपए का उसका मुनाफा होता है तो वो 100 रुपए मुझे इंटरेस्ट लोन का देने में उसको दिक्कत नहीं है क्योंकि 400 रुपए फिर भी उसके बच रहे हैं. यहाँ पे अगर मैं 100 रुपए को ओवर 1,000 रुपीज देखता हूँ तो 10% प्रतिदिन का ब्याज आता है, तो हमें लगता है कि इंटरेस्ट रेट बहुत ज्यादा है. लेकिन अगर हम इस सेगमेंट को देखें जहां नीड्स आइडेंटिफाई कर रहे हैं कि स्केलेबल एंटरप्राइजेस जो ग्रोथ स्टेज में जा रहे हैं, 3-4 लाख रुपए का सालाना रेवेन्यू है, उस तरफ अगर हम जाएं तो वहां पे ये लोन्स शायद 20-22% में हर महिला के लिए सस्टेनेबल ना हो. देयरफॉर एफआई की रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी अगर उनको ये सेगमेंट 12-14% में लेंड करना पड़े, देयरफॉर व्हाट इज द सपोर्ट दैट एफआईज नीड, एंड दैट इज वेयर द लीड्स एंड द एफएलडीजी एलिमेंट्स एंड सपोर्ट फ्रॉम आउटकम फंडर्स कम इनटू प्ले. द आउटकम फंडिंग पार्ट एसेंशियली इंप्लाइज कि इन सर्विसेज के अगेंस्ट में जो रेम्यूनरेशन है वो सर्विस डिलीवरी के बाद मिलेंगी रादर देन अपफ्रंट, एंड दैट्स द ब्रॉडर कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ दिस डिस्कशन जहां पे हम आपसे समझना चाहेंगे कि जब हम इस तरह के किसी कॉन्ट्रेक्चुअल अग्रीमेंट को एग्जीक्यूट करने जाएंगे ऑन ग्राउंड तो किस तरह की पोटेंशियल चैलेंजेस आती हैं बेसिस योर एक्सपीरियंसेस, और हम कैसे इसको ओवरकम कर सकते हैं ताकि हम इस तरह के सॉल्यूशंस को मार्केट में इंप्लीमेंट कर सके और इन महिलाओं को सपोर्ट कर सके. और यहाँ पे मैं एक पॉज लेना चाहूंगा और अमित जी को इनवाइट करना चाहूंगा वर्ल्ड बैंक से, जो इस तरह के स्ट्रक्चर्स के साथ काफी एक्सपेरिमेंट कर रहे हैं और कुछ जगह पे उन्होंने इस तरह के कॉन्वर्सेशंस को इंप्लीमेंट करने की भी कोशिश की है. टू जस्ट प्रॉब्ली कम एंड यू नो शेयर सम इंट्रोडक्टरी रिमार्क्स अराउंड यू नो व्हाट योर एक्सपीरियंसेस हैव बीन अराउंड द रिजल्ट बेस्ड फाइनेंसिंग फ्रेमवर्क स्पेसिफिकली इन दिस सेगमेंट, एंड व्हाट आर द की पॉइंट लर्निंग पॉइंट्स दैट गाइडिंग प्रिंसिपल्स दैट वी नीड टू फॉलो एज वी मूव अहेड विद एन इंटरवेंशन लाइक दिस.
Thanks, Abhishek. This is very interesting and you know makes my task easier. You know, आपने काफी चीजें डिटेल में एक्सप्लेन की हैं. At the onset, this is something which is still building up. You know, we don't have proven templates or examples of how to do this, and this is seen in different forms. You know, some would call it PPPs, blended finance, impact finance, and all of that jargons come into play. But to simply put it. If we take the MFI financing as a benchmark, group financing क्यों इतने scale पे हुई? क्योंकि risk कम है, margins better हैं, और convenience है जिस तरीके से वो deliver होता है. So it's a win-win for demand and supply. ठीक है, but as you move up the ladder, the costs are higher, so that needs to be addressed. The risks are higher, that needs to be addressed. Hence, the need for, you know, bringing in all this, what you're saying. Now, obviously, there is a layer of cost jo lender nahi afford kar sakta hai, or, and obviously, borrower bhi nahi afford kar sakta hai. So we need service providers, aggregators in between who play that role, you know, to their strengths. This could be the likes of Mavim, or this could be Vruti, you know, who are closer to the ground, understand the ecosystem there, but how to bear this cost. So this comes back to the design. Normally, when a project is designed, it's more supply side thinking, or depending upon who the sponsor is, us orientation se uski thinking hoti hai, no? Agar, if it is a corporate, then that kind of design thinking comes. Or if it is a government, then, you know, it has its own way of thinking. I think what to make this as a, you know, successful initiative or a project, you know, Bala would say projects don't work. It's important that we have a open mindset to try and structure PPPs which play to the strengths of each stakeholders. You know, there could be a philanthropy funding to take care of some gaps. There could be government funding, or, you know, donor fund, government funding, which takes care of input costs, you know, because that's also essential. Purely based on outcomes, it will be difficult to kickstart this because the costs start on day one. And then there are, you know, lenders who come into the picture and finance these projects, but need a risk assurance. So that aspect needs to be taken care of. A couple of examples I'll give, you know, to come now to the point that you, you know, flagged. We're trying to attempt in some form in some of our projects to address these problems. For example, in Assam, there is a World Bank project in partnership with Assam government called APART, where an alternate investment fund is being created, where X amount of money would be put it primarily to leverage more funding from the private sector. So that investments can be made in such enterprises. It could be combination of loan equity. That's one aspect. Now, the risk of giving, you know, government money 100% as grant is that, you know, you're not telling them that you need to stand up on their feet. So it has to be combination of public-private investments. Plus, there is an element of TA cost also in this, because the spade work that is required to prepare this pipeline, that cost is addressed through this kind of a TA. That's one example where all these stakeholders can come together. Another example, if I may give, this is also still at a design stage, is a project in Tamil Nadu with the state government there, focusing on women enterprises, micro enterprises, both collective and individual, where we're saying, instead of giving direct grant to these women borrowers or enterprises, we convert this as a conditional incentive which comes through the lender. So an X amount is paid to the borrower at the end of the loan tenure if the repayments are prompt. So, it, you know, in today's parlance, you can see this as a cashback. Agar loan times have wapis diya, to 10-20% aapko baad mein wapis mil jayega. So, you know, your cost of funds come down and there is an incentive to repay. The second part to this is, just in case this money doesn't come back, then that incentive amount goes to the lender as a risk sharing facility. So the lender's risks are also to an extent addressed. But the eventuality is one of the two. So dono mein se ek bhi surat mein ek na ek side ko fayda hoga. This is also supported by a TA layer on ground through a service partner. Whose job is to ensure that a pipeline is built of creditable borrowers and is paid through a separate pipe. You know, currently, this is input-based, but gradually, this could become as an outcome-based funding when there is enough scale to, you know, lead us to that confidence. So I think this is only possible when multiple stakeholders come together and play a role in effectively designing a solution which addresses the various moving parts which we see as a problem. I'll pause there, but there are more examples. You know, not, this is not something which only World Bank is doing. There are various players out there in the corporate sector who are doing this in agri sector also. Recently, Rabo, USAID, DCDO have set up a facility which is trying to address this problem in the agri space. So lot, these solutions need to be encouraged more and more. My second point, maybe I'll come in detail later. Currently, there is no incentive for a lender to focus on women-led enterprises, especially collectives. Koi priority sector benefit alag se is cheez ke liye nahi hai. Koi target bhi nahi hai. Aur challenges bahut saare hain, toh main kyun karun? So that matrix needs to be put in place, either as a policy measure or a regulatory measure, which encourages this for, you know, few years. Agar 10,000 FPO program government nahi banayegi, toh aur 10 saal tak hum incrementally hi chalte rahenge. Of course, mortality rate may be higher. But given the scale of opportunity or the need, we need to work in that mode. Also, it has its own benefits. So that's also an element which we need to, you know, think through. Thanks.
Thank you, Amit, for that opening remarks. Very helpful examples. I'm sure a lot of our audience members would be benefited by them and will probably be guided by these thoughts, as we will be. Priya, can we move to the next slide, please? And with this, I'll probably now come to Raman as well as Nirmala to seek their views. You know, just from a perspective of being able to cater to these informal segments and these informal groups, as an FI, what are the basic requirements that you would be needing to be able to serve this segment? And I'll also probably request Rekha ji to weigh in her thoughts since she's already doing some of these segments. किस तरह के डॉक्यूमेंट्स, किस तरह के कागजात, किस तरह की हिस्ट्री, क्या चीज आप लोग देखते हैं जब इस तरह के ग्रुप को आप लोग लेंड करने की कोशिश करते हैं या इन महिलाओं को लेंड करने की कोशिश करते हैं जो किसी समूह का हिस्सा रही हो लेकिन शायद आप काम अपने इंडिविजुअल कैपेसिटी में करने की कोशिश कर रही हो. कई बार इनके पास आपको कागजात या बुक्स नहीं मिलेंगे, अधिकतम केसेस में शायद नहीं मिले. तो इस केसेस में आप लोग आगे कैसे बढ़ते हैं? रेखा जी, अगर आप अपने एक्सपीरियंसेस शुरू करें एंड फिर रमन एंड निर्मला, आई विल रिक्वेस्ट फॉर योर थॉट्स एज टू हाउ दिस कुड पोटेंशियली वर्क आउट, बिकॉज दिस विल देन फीड इन इनटू द काइंड ऑफ कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग सपोर्ट द सर्विस प्रोवाइडर्स वुड हैव टू प्रोवाइड एंड क्रिएट इन टर्म्स ऑफ अ पाइपलाइन फॉर द एफआईज टू देन कम इन एंड लेंड. विद दैट इन द कॉन्टेक्स्ट, रेखा जी, अगर आपकी कोई ओपनिंग रिमार्क्स हो कि आप लोग कैसे करते हैं इस सेगमेंट में, क्या रिक्वायरमेंट्स रखते हैं?
तो एक तो अभी कैसे है, क्रेडिट रेटिंग टूल जो हमने बनाया हुआ है, जो महिलाओं को कितने बार सर्कल लोन हुआ है, अभी वो कितना इनकम कमा रही है, उसका क्या है. लेकिन कई बार क्या होता है, उसके पास फाइनेंशियल स्टेटमेंट्स कुछ नहीं रहते हैं, तो एटलीस्ट हम उसको मोटिवेट करते हैं जो भी वो ट्रांजेक्शन कर रही है वो डिजिटलाइज करे, तो हम उसका सिर्फ स्टेटमेंट भी आप सेविंग का देखेंगे तो हमें पता चल जाएगा कि उसका सेल कितना हो रहा है, प्रॉफिट कितना हो रहा है. क्योंकि बहुत बार क्या होता है, इन महिलाओं के पास ऐसे कुछ फाइनेंशियल स्टेटमेंट नहीं होते हैं और हम देखते हैं कि वो कितनी हम उसको ईज सब डॉक्यूमेंटेशन करने के लिए सपोर्ट कर रहे, तो वो मुझे कहीं ना कहीं लगता है कि वो ज्यादा से ज्यादा लोन लेने में ज्यादा उसको फायदा होता है. क्योंकि हमारा ना अभी सिटपे के साथ भी टाइप है, हमारे एसबीआई के साथ भी टाइप है, इन महिलाओं को कम लोन में कम इंटरेस्ट में लोन मिले. लेकिन जो पेपर्स मांगते हैं एसबीआई या सिटपे, तो वो पेपर्स इन महिलाओं के लिए पॉसिबल नहीं है. तो मुझे कहीं ना कहीं लगता है कि इन महिलाओं को ई से लोन देना हम देखे तो और उसमें हेल्प करे. अभी कैसे हमारे मानदेशी महिला बैंक है और मानदेशी फाउंडेशन है, तो इन महिलाओं का जो भी कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग अभी आपने लास्ट स्ट्रक्चर जो दिखाया, तो सेम वही हम कर रहे हैं कि मानदेशी फाउंडेशन ए महिलाओं का जो भी कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग का काम कर रही है और मानदेशी बैंक उसको लेंड कर रही है उसी महिलाओं को, तो वहां हम देख रहे हैं कि उसका क्वालिटी क्या रहेगा प्रोडक्ट का. और ये भी
कैसे असेस कर रहे हैं आप, क्या प्राइमरीली उनके बैंक स्टेटमेंट्स के बेसिस पे लेंडिंग ले रहे हैं और उनके बैंक में ट्रांजैक्शंस आपको दिख रहे हैं इन महिलाओं के?
इज दैट सर, कैसे अभी कैसे हम फाउंडेशन की तरफ से इन्हीं महिलाओं को हम डिजिटल ट्रांजैक्शन कैसे करें ये सिखा रहे हैं. हमारे पास मोबाइल बस है, उसमें एटीएम सेटअप किया हुआ है, उसमें एक टीवी लगाया है, तो हम अलग अलग उसको वीडियो प्ले करके उन महिलाओं को उनका डिजिटल लिटरेसी कैसे बढ़ाए ये देख रहे हैं. तो उन्हीं महिलाओं को हम ये भी ट्रैक कर रहे हैं कि उनके फाइनेंशियल स्टेटमेंट जो आ रहे हैं ना, तो उसमें वो डिजिटलाइज कितने ट्रांजेक्शन कर रही है,
आप लोग सिर्फ उन्हीं महिलाओं को सपोर्ट कर रहे हैं जो डिजिटल सेल्स कर रहे हैं, डिजिटल ट्रांजैक्शंस कर रहे हैं, बिकॉज़ वहीं पे आपको डिजिटल डेटा मिल रहा है टू बी एबल टू असेस क्रेडिट,
तो उन महिलाओं का असेसमेंट करने में आसानी हो जाती है.
करेक्ट.
ऐसा नहीं है कि उनको ही हम लोन कर रहे हैं, बाकी सारे भी चीजें हैं. लेकिन अभी जैसे ये डिजिटलाइजेशन सब बढ़ रहा है, हम देख रहे हैं ना कि इन महिलाओं का बिजनेस भी बनाना है और उनको कहीं ना कहीं ये सब फाइनेंशियल डॉक्यूमेंट्स उतनी वो पढ़ी लिखी नहीं है, ये सब चीजें प्रॉफिट एंड लॉस अकाउंट मेंटेन करें, बैलेंस शीट मेंटेन करें, उसके लिए पॉसिबल नहीं है. लेकिन वो डिजिटल ट्रांजेक्शन करने के लिए तुरंत सीख जाती है. तो वो असेसमेंट कैसे करके कैसे हम उसको लोन दे और उसको कैसे सिखाए, ये अभी देख रहे हैं. और ये चीजें सिर्फ एक डिजिटल ट्रांजेक्शन का हो गया, लेकिन उसके साथ साथ ही में वो कौन सी बिजनेस कर रही है, उसकी क्वालिटी क्या मेंटेन कर रही है, वो अभी किसी ने ऑर्डर दिया तो उस टाइम के अंदर वो उतना क्वांटिटी दे पाती है क्या, ये सब चीजें. और ये सब चीजों का हम फाउंडेशन की तरफ से उसको सपोर्ट कर रहे हैं. और यही एक चीज नहीं है सर, और एक चीज है जो अभी हमारा ई प्लेटफॉर्म जो महिलाओं को आइटम्स बेचने का है, ये फाइनेंशियल स्टेटमेंट का हो गया, लेकिन उसका हम ई प्लेटफॉर्म जो भी है वो बिजनेस कर रहे हैं, तो उसको खरीदारी करने के लिए उसका 10 भी हो रहा है, ऑर्डर 10 भी आ रहे मंथली, तो उसका उसमें ग्रोथ हो रहा है क्या, वो भी हम आइडेंटिफाई कर रहे हैं कि वो ऑनलाइन पे अभी उसका बिजनेस लेके जा रही है, वो भी वहां पे टाइम पे वो ऑर्डर पे कर रही है क्या. अभी इस महीने में उसके 10 है, लेकिन 10 नेक्स्ट महीने में उसके 12 या 20 हुए है क्या. ये सब चीजें हमारा खुद का क्रेडिट टूल हमने बनाया है. तो हम ये नए नए चीजें, नए इनोवेशन ला के हमारा क्रेडिट रेटिंग टूल थोड़ा सा जो ग्रास रूट की महिलाएं हैं उनको कैसे आसान हो जाएगा, ये देख के हम उनको लैंड और सपोर्ट कर रहे हैं.
राइट, थैंक यू मैम. निर्मला एंड रमन, इफ आई कैन कम टू यू एट दिस स्टेज, आई नो यू've हर्ड ऑल ऑफ दिस कन्वर्सेशन फॉर अ व्हाइल नाउ, यू हैव अ सेंस ऑफ व्हाट दिस सेगमेंट एसेंशियली विल लुक लाइक. From your perspective, as Rekha ji was suggesting, ki unki taraf se ek key measure jahan pe credit assessment becomes easier is tracking of digital transactions, jo unki foundation hi support kar rahi hai. But absence that, for an FI such as you, on one hand we have an NBFC, and on the other hand we have a bank which is constrained way more with regulations and the kind of requirements that presses on. What is the kind of requirement you will need in order to be able to proceed with a 50,000 to a 1 lakh, 2 lakh kind of a loan in this segment, which essentially goes out to women who are either in groups of 2, 3, 4, or 5 and running a business? Kya basic eligibility criteria hogi aapki? Kis tarah se aap assess kar payenge and kin conditions pe hi you'll be able to advance a loan? If you can share some perspectives, maybe Raman, you can start with, and then I'll request Nirmala also to reflect from a banking view.
Yeah, so thanks, Abhishek. So we do a couple of things. Just to add to the entire conversation context is that 50% of our customers are new to credit, which means that they have not been a part of formal digital systems in the past, but we work hard to bring these customers also to the mainstream finance. From a paper point of view, we follow the entire digital footprint in a sense that Aadhaar is there, so which basically helps us to onboard customer quickly, so which doesn't put too much of a burden on the customer. Apart from that, we cater to multiple segments like Kirana, merchant, saloon, grocery, and others. So we have our own templates, which basically helps us to underwrite to a certain extent that even if the customer doesn't have a digital footprint, the transaction data, how do we underwrite them? So we have our own models which basically feed into the credit engine, which basically says that, okay, if the business looks like this, its shop is at a particular place, this is the distance between a shop and the market, and the total number of SKUs in the shop, we underwrite to a certain extent and we underwrite the customer to that extent. So that's one part, which is basically high touch. In absence of, the digital footprint, we also cater to the customers who are digitally savvy also. So what happens in that case that customers, they can download an SDK/mobile app. They can self-onboard. They need not to walk into our stores or the branches or the Kendras. And the credit is given to them. So the couple of things also we have been doing it now, which is coming into fruition, is that So we also see, Abhishek, is that what is the overall cost levers we need to work on? One of the context that came in the past is that on the supply side and the demand side, the cost has to be one of the factors which needs to be looked at. For example, we cannot inconvenience our customers again and again for the KYC process. So we have been working on this. So we are coming with some of the features where the KYC is done by the customers within the regulations. We can provide a line of credit, which basically provides to the customer. And the customer can withdraw limit as and when a customer wants to do that. So that the entire process of KYC is done once, and based on the business requirements and the capital requirement, customer can just withdraw the money on the go. So that's one of the piece. Apart from that, we take due care in terms of onboarding the customers also. And in our previous context, the conversation context, we have seen that we need to look at for qualified leads, which basically reduce the overall cost of conversion to us. The moment we get the qualified leads, the overall operation cost reduces to a certain extent. And some of the mitigants what we have done that is that the entire money moves into the bank account. In fact, the entire industry is moving towards that. We are trying to reduce the overall cash collection also. So these are some of the efficiencies we are building over period of time, and we are seeing good traction in that. I agree with Rekha ji on this, that one of the work, in fact, within our own organization we are doing is that how do we basically create market linkages for the customers? How do we basically create more digital for the customers? What it basically helps is that the customer becomes more empowered as and when you start creating a lot of digital footprints from the customer. So there's some work which is in the pipeline. A platform is coming sooner or later, which basically will help our customers to connect with the brands, to have a market linkages, so that the entire integration, be it on the forward side, be it on the backward side, on the supply chain side, will be able to do that. So these are a couple of things we are doing.
Thanks for that, Raman. Nirmala, would you like to come in with your thoughts and views in terms of eligibility requirements and documentary needs that a bank would need in this segment?
Sure, Abhishek. Firstly, thanks for this. And then I think the supply side challenges, which has been brought out, I think it's actually bang on. The high cost of servicing, difficulty in reaching the segment and all. So that's where I mean, at Investment Bank, we actually strongly believe that the branch-led model may not work in terms of reaching out to this target segment. Because a typical branch staff would have 100 odd things, and then if we ask him or her to actually reach out to the women collectors and all, it may not actually be of interest to that person too, and also will not be able to make any impact. So that's where I think the grassroots organizations like what Prithi, Mavim and all are playing a great role. So our belief is in terms of actually tying up with these organizations to reach out to the target segment. Now, when coming to the approach and documentation, how do we do? We have actually adopted a digital approach, which is high touch, yes, powered by digital apps and all. So we have given app to the BCs who would be representing the bank on the ground, and then they'll be collecting documentation. When I say documentation, of course, want to put it as quantitative and qualitative. In the sense, when I say quantitative, it is the typical KYC and the passbook, loan account statement, the previous loan account statement, transaction history, bookkeeping and all. And some soft information which the BC would actually, the BC service provider in this terms, I'm interchangeably using it. So who would capture this information for us, which also goes into the credit underwriting process. For example, right now we are working with the entrepreneurs who are from SCGs, parent SCGs and all. So the soft information from the ground in terms of the household performance, any issues with the household or any issues with the earlier parent SCGs and all. So those are the soft information which we are capturing in terms of the documentation. So it goes both in terms of the physical form and then also the soft information which flows into the bank. And our credit underwriting process captures or considers both of this. Right. That's from a documentation perspective. In terms of the risk mitigation, You know, I think this is where every banker would have, how am I actually recovering the money which has been lent? So FLDGs, and also in terms of when we say FLDG, and also what is the science behind arriving at, if we say 5%, 10% or not? So do we have the crystallized credit costs or NPS? NPS, of course, for SHGs we may have, but for this target segment and also, so do we have that, or is there any method to arrive at that? Because basically it should cover the back on this. So that's where I think we need to arrive at some metrics on this. And in terms of the outcomes, I think while one of the metric it says in design construct is on the number of loans disbursed. I think one of my colleagues here in this forum also have touched upon this. It should be, I think, performing loans or portfolio seasoning. So that's where, because else probably the skin in the game of a service provider and all might not long last. So this is these are some of our thoughts on this construct.
Thank you so much, Nirmala ji. That's very helpful. And that sets the context for the next slide, Priya, if we can move into, because essentially what we've heard from all our FI partners is that, number one, there's an overarching focus on assessing the capacities through digital means, and therefore tracking digital data that is available or equipping. And therefore, one of the essential elements of capacity building is in terms of creating digital footprints for the target beneficiaries. And some documentary requirements, which Nirmala ji, you mentioned as hard requirements, be it on the KYC side or loan account statements, past performance transact, business books, etc. Given this, that this is some of the key requirements that is coming up, I want to quickly check with Mr. Bala as well as Kusum ji on their experiences of how, you know, some of these interventions have been delivered on ground working with the groups. What is the cost it entails, and what is the timeline it takes to equip or bring beneficiaries to a level where they can absorb this credit of a larger ticket size, you know? And for the benefit, maybe we can go to the next slide also, which has some reference indicators of the kind of capacity building curriculum or needs. You know, primarily looking at four key types, the formalization stages, what we are looking at, the hard documentary requirements that came up in the conversation. And then financial management and digital literacy is essentially the part that most supply side participants on the conversation laid focus on, in terms of understanding of digital means, digital payment platforms, or mobile apps, POS machines, making them comfortable in accepting digital payments, and then using that transaction data to be able to underwrite loans of larger ticket sizes. So Bala, your thoughts first, your experiences of creating these training modules or administering these trainings, can these be done over 10 to 15 sessions with the groups of women combined, over a 1 or 2 hour session each? What is the best way forward? What would be the cost for driving a training program such as this? Some of them pre-dispersal, some of them post-dispersal, and therefore enable, you know, get a sense to the house here in terms of what kind of capacity building costs we are looking at for supporting a certain number of women. Let's take the target case of 100 women being provided these trainings. How would you as a practitioner deliver these trainings, over what time, and what would be the cost involved?
Yep. Thank you, Abhishek. I think these training, which is largely which we are looking at it using for these collectives or the enterprises, one, first of all, understanding and doing the diagnosis of it. And for any of the enterprises which we understand, using the diagnostics tool, which will help us to prioritize what are the kind of top three challenges they are facing currently to kind of to move in the growth path or to sustain themselves. Then also at the producer collective level, which we are also looking at, where are they moving, which we need to also understand. And then the gaps, which we use a tool called PCAT, which is a producer organization institutional capacity assessment tool, which will help us to understand the governance and the staff, where are they are currently. Then based on that, we are able to kind of help them to move from X to X plus. Yeah, that's one thing which we are following it up. And the training, which recently, I think this pandemic also helped us to reimagine the capacity building program itself. Yeah, earlier, which is always, it's a classroom, and it is high cost, yeah, and which is the trainer going and delivering. Now, which we have been building content on e-learning modules, which is on micro-learning, because we also found that the all of us, we also agree that the retention, what do you call, the attention after a kind of a number of hours, it's very difficult for the communities and the collectives. Can we have a micro-learning and small bites? Yeah, which will help. And also, how do we leverage the cost? You do it as a e-learning module, then it is always, it's available, then you train your, but it's required, I think many of us were saying, it's about digital now, because you need technology, but you need a human interface, because not all of our communities are having smartphones, which is only future phones they are having. And when we are talking about women, I think most of them, it is, they are not having, because their son or daughter or the husband will be having, but not by the woman themselves. Yeah. And when it comes in, then you need the interface where the last mile we are having, like in the CRPs, or we in Vritti, we have Agribusiness Accelerator, who is given smartphone or the tab, then they are able to facilitate these program on the ground. The cost is minimized, because you are already, the module is developed, then you do the training of trainers of these community members, and then they are able to deliver it. And we are also having a guided mentoring session, because there will be question coming back from this, these trainings. Then they are not able to address some of these by the field teams, by the last mile delivery person. What we are looking at it, can we have a experts who are like, who is somebody good at legal and strategic compliances, or somebody good at financial management, that person will guide them again, how to go about and addressing these questions coming back from the field. Then that also, it's becoming a kind of FAQ or document. Then they are being given this document to our members. This we are piloting in now one location. Now we are actually trying to scale up using a technology platform and to all other locations. Yeah, that is which, but the cost is a bit higher, because when it comes to a user, it is about, what do you call, it's coming around 10,000 rupees per year. Yeah, for using this platform. Yeah. Then if it is one member, if I'm having a 40 people, then I need at least 4 lakh rupees for the last mile delivery. Yeah. Per year. It is a per year renewal charge, which is, but you are able to also get the dashboard. How many times this training has been conducted, to whom is being conducted. You are able to also use a QR code based kind of attestation you are able to do who participated in the training. Yeah. If somebody is having a smartphone at the participant level also, they will have access to these modules later post the training program as well. Yeah. Then they can actually refresh themselves in their whatever leisure time. That is one, which is we are looking at it. For again, which we are looking at for the producer collective also, similar like the governance related, operation management related, all these. It's, but the we believe it's about, we need about, it takes about 6 to kind of a 12 months period. It based on what do you call the stage in which these organizations are there. Yeah. The cost also, I think the other day when I was discussing with Mayur also, it varies, because we are talking about collectives here, about 2 members are also, because the women coming together, they formed a collective, which is 2 members, it's an activity group. Yeah. Then the cost is sometime, because the delivery cost is very high. And because you need to reach to the last mile, because you cannot bring them for a 2-hour session to a cluster place, then again, your transportation cost, or they may not be able to come also, because how do you, then you need to deliver it on the ground using your last mile delivery person. Then the cost will definitely will increase. Yeah. That's the, I think this is the kind of experience which we are having, but we also felt, I think one is you keep assessing there, whether because you have a diagnostic you have done, and in the mid course also you understand where is it actually they are there post the training. And then in mid course also you are able to do some corrections if in case you're required to change certain kind of topics, or you may need to do something else, because you assessed when you started something, and during the course you also look at and change mid course the different topics or different support mechanisms are required. And we are also, the recent thing which we are also looking at, can we also have some kind of panel of mentors in for different region who are able to address their challenges and doubts whenever they require. Yeah. Can we have that kind of mechanism also? Like, can we support these collectives and the enterprises as a kind of clinic, which is or the telecall, like how we have a telemedicine support? Can we have a similar kind of mechanism which will also help them and enable them to their doubts and their challenges is cleared when it is arising? Yeah. These are all the mechanisms which we are trying to build currently within the organization to support these enterprises and collectives.
Right. This is very helpful, Bala. Thank you for that perspective. Kusumji, would you like to add anything very quickly from your side in terms of the costs perspective?
Yeah, I think whatever Balaji has said, it is absolutely correct, and that is what we are also doing. But only I would like to say the institutional building is a huge cost. Just because IFAD was with us and the period is long. 6 to 7 years we have really worked on institution building, and therefore in that period we have had each and every household which we are dealing with. They have their PAN card, they have Aadhaar card, they have their own individual accounts in the Janadhana or something. So such kind of campaigns we have conducted and we done with that, so that the at least minimum basic KYCs can be with them. And then capacity building about the functional literacy, the financial literacy, this type of literacy level program, and how the investments can flow and this thing. But these trainings, we generally found that it is lots of refresher training needs to be happened. It is not one go, one training happen and then forget it, because they have to learn, 3-4 times one session has to be repeated as a refresher trainings, and that is very much needed. That is what our experience says. Secondly, I would say this soft issues has to be really delegated, and the investment has to be there, because visible result you don't show, you cannot show, because how much women has learned, it will take a time to show the results. But the, and therefore the investors are not have a patience. We have invested and show us the results. So that is something, it's a huge time we have to spend with them. That's all. Thank you.
These are very important takeaways, which I was going to come to. The outcome yardsticks that a structure like this needs to have, you know, what kind of outputs we can expect to reasonably extract within a period of 1 to 2 years, based on which the payments could be made. What are the indicators that could provide a reasonable proxy of those outputs and the eventual outcomes that are being targeted? So while I seek answer on this, I'll just hold that thought for a while and quickly check on the other important parameter which we wanted to quickly take everyone's views on, is for these monies to be provided for either the capacity building part or for the FLDG or for the incentive to the FIs, the broad spectrum of stakeholders from who these could come from, these are either our philanthropic organizations in the form of foundations, or potentially CSR money under the new route, and there's a bit of a gray area here. I know, I understand, even though there are regulatory changes that are happening, there are no precedent cases based on which you can go ahead in that direction. And therefore, you know, it remains a bit of a gray area how CSR money could be channelized in. Or, organizations such as World Bank, who can only intervene with a state government agency in between, right? So with these three sources being into play and regulations like FCRA into play, how can these monies be effectively routed to end beneficiaries, which could be agencies like Vruti, which is a not-for-profit and therefore may not have an issue? I'm just preempting this, but Bala, you could potentially comment in here in accessing these funds, versus an entity like a IndusInd or Earth, which are for-profit bodies and banks, and therefore can donor monies or incentives be routed to these agencies, and if so, how? Any quick thoughts on this, Amit, basis your experience, what have you noted, and then I'll also potentially check with our audiences if they have any thoughts on this or any questions around this.
Sure, Abhishek, thanks. I'll just take a moment to go back to the previous point and comment on that to link it to what you were saying. See, a lot of support activities which were listed and, you know, fellow colleagues mentioned about are something which are, you know, agnostic to the type of institution. Sabke liye chahiye. Bookkeeping, accounting, sabko chahiye. you know, whether it is, you know, the FPO or an individual enterprises or women enterprises or, you know, male-led enterprise, so some of these can be standardized and universally made available. This will make life easy for everyone. You know, imagine 10,000 FPOs now trying to figure out ki hum tally le ya ABC le aur kya kare. And then the second layer problem of trying to collate information from all of them and putting into one stack. So I think, you know, some SaaS kind of a model which makes it easier for them to take the solution as a plug and play and use this. Second is certain incentives or, you know, supports solutions are required to digitize payments for these nano enterprises. Currently, it is not as easy or as good or cost effective as cash. There is a cost attached to it in most of the solutions that are being provided, whether it is an Aadhaar Pay or anything else. This has to be as good as cash, if not better than cash in terms of cost, either to the service provider or to the EE user. That will make life easier. Agar books of records bhi nahi maintain ho rahe digitally, but transactions, payments jo hai bank account mein reflect kar rahe hain, we still have a good case. So I think these two building blocks are very, very important to, you know, ensure the credit flows a little more seamlessly vis-a-vis today. Coming to the point you made, I think structures can be created to serve the purpose from both for-profit and non-profit routes, you know, whether it is to get in to incubate this with a non-lender who has an FCRA or to give a guarantee to a financial institution. And there are examples of both kinds. Where the equilibrium gets established, that is, you know, a more important question where one needs to see this. So that's very much possible. One thing I would like to highlight here is, though this may be transactionally a little more complicated to start with, but in terms of scale over a period of time, this would be probably more helpful. There are a large number of financial cooperatives of varied kinds across the country who are not very well formalized or digitized. No, but you know, they have their own loan book size of 1 crore, 2 crore. They may not be having a, you know, loan management system, but they are very well connected to the last mile. Now, this could be a primary agricultural cooperative society. This could be a federation under NRLM framework, or, you know, there are various variants. For example, MABIM has a very good structure on ground, which, you know, connects to the SHGs and SHG members, which is leveraged to give, you know, loans to these SHGs. Somewhere down the line, if we can leverage that ecosystem for them to have a skin in the game over a period of time, they contribute to the risk that is taken. And that would make it a scalable model. It may not happen on day one, but over a period of time, you know, this has to move from an external service provider to these community-led institutions who can manage this effectively. So, for example, if Raman has to lend to an SHG member who's running a Kirana shop under the MAVIM framework, it is very difficult for Earth or Raman to figure out who's this borrower and what is her capacity and data points. Actually, it is that federation who should be the extended arm of Earth or any other lender who is able to generate that information, be it for IndusInd or Earth, I'm just giving an example, generate that information, get a part of the return, but as well share the risk. If you are able to standardize that model and templatize this, I think there, you know, there could be a scalable arrangement going forward. So I'll pause there. But donors or impact in funders providing this risk sharing facility, that can be worked out either ways.
Right. So if I understand you correctly, Amit, you're trying to draw attention towards channelizing this money through community institutions like CLF, where they come in on the risk sharing part and maybe some incentive or some assistance is provided to them, which they could use to extend those risk mitigation products. So right now they are mostly doing lending out of the corpus that they have, and therefore there's no leverage that's coming into play. You're essentially trying to see whether that corpus can be used as a guarantee fund, or part of the corpus can be used as a guarantee fund. So there's a leverage effect. And then FIs like Earth and industry and
environment. Yeah.
Yeah, makes sense. Thanks for those insights. Very quick question now as we summarize. Can we go to the next slide, please? In terms of the outcomes, you know, how do we look at the entire space? We've discussed the women collectives. We've looked at the broader objective is to help them grow, which is to be measured in revenue growth. We've heard, our panelists talk about how growth is very activity-based, may happen on day one, may happen 1 year down the line, may not happen in 1 year's time, depending on the kind of activities that are being processed. So if the outcome that the foundations or, you know, is agencies supporting these interventions is revenue growth, how can this outcome be broken down into outputs based on which FIs and service providers could potentially, you know, intervene? You know, are milestones like number of loans, quantum of loans, number of trainings, are these the right kind of outputs to go after? If so, what is the right way to measure this from an M&E cost in order to keep the program costs at the bare minimum? And there's a trade-off involved there as well, right? How diligently we want to do the M&E? Do we want to do M&E of all the beneficiaries? Do we want to do a sample check of the beneficiaries, etc.? Any perspectives around that for anyone who's worked in this space or has looked into this space? Leave it open. Please sort of come in basis your perspectives here on the outcome side. How do we translate the larger outcome towards outputs based on which these rewards or incentives could be offered to both service providers and FIs as a donor body or as an incentivizer, outcome funder? Bala, any thoughts from your end? Otherwise, I'll request Raman as well as Nirmala to weigh in their thoughts as to what outputs they can potentially agree on. And those will be crucial inputs as we think this forward.
Yeah, no, as you have mentioned, I think some of the things, the output level, I think absolutely seems to be fine, which is on based on certain diagnosis or which we agree on, these are all the things which should be delivered, which can be measured into outputs, where also we will also align with the feedbacks from the collectives as well. Yeah, both the outputs which we deliver on the number of trainings, plus something maybe if it is a business plan required or some systems and processes needs to be put in place, all that which can be measured. The second also, how do we also, where maybe not only the kind of the fee which needs to be paid to service provider, can we also, I think when Amit was mentioning, there is an incentive which is also given at when we achieve the outcomes. Yeah, can we also, there is a outcome measurement also can be brought in. Output, there can be certain things can be released. Then when it goes into outcome, that can be a kind of third party who will assess the outcomes based on the financial transaction from the banking side. Plus the repayment and the growth which has been agreed during the diagnosis and the plan which we put out. Those, one is at the outcome level on the whatever the X we wanted to see each of the enterprises are growing. I think these two can be given output and outcome basis.
Thanks, Bala. That is helpful. Anyone else would like to weigh in? Otherwise, we can quickly go to audiences. I think there are a few questions coming in from there as well, and maybe take a couple of questions quickly.
So just to add one point, if we have to scale the entire model across the country, we need to build efficiency in the system, which means, as we were delving this topic earlier, that the entire operational thing has to be looked at. It basically boils down to the conversion, how many qualified leads are coming. That basically makes the overall proposition between both for the service provider as well as for the FI, as well as for the borrower also. So as long as these three, four things are in place, along with, I'll say, the skin in the game, the risk sharing, and the portfolio quality, so then this model can be scaled to any level we can think of.
Valid point, Raman. That's very crucial for sustainability as well. I think there are some questions from the audiences. I know Kusumji has had to leave because of another meeting, but quickly, one question from Rekhaji and Kusumji, which I think they partially answered, is how do we see the digitization efforts on offline transaction data yielding results. What efforts have been going on from Mandeshi's perspective as well as from Mavim's perspective in this direction, and to what extent are these yielding results? I'm guessing this is around digitization of transaction data, or is it around bookkeeping? I'm not sure from the question, but maybe quick perspective on payment data as well as books of accounts. Any perspective there? What is the effort that's going on, and how are these translating into actual outcomes on ground? To what extent are women able to pivot to digital transactions or bookkeeping? रेखा जी आपकी तरफ से
तो मुझे यहाँ पे अभी जब डिजिटलाइजेशन की बात आती है तो जैसे पैंडेमिक में ना हर घर में मोबाइल्स आए हुए हैं, क्योंकि जैसे अभी स्कूल का बहुत सारा बच्चों के लिए मोबाइल पे क्लासेस चल रही थी, तो महिलाओं के हाथ पे एंड्रॉयड फोन आ गए हैं। तो मुझे यहाँ शेयर करने में ये रहेगा कि करीब हमारी अभी 40% महिलाएं रिपेमेंट ऑनलाइन कर रही है पेंडेमिक में। तो ये कि उनको यदि अच्छी तरह से उनको, और मैं यहाँ एग्जांपल भी शेयर करना चाहती हूँ, उनको वो पढ़े भीड़े नहीं है तो हमारे जो रिकवरी ऑफिसर उनके घर पे जाते हैं तो उनको ट्रांजेक्शन करने के लिए वहां पे सिखाते हैं सामने बैठ के। तो ऐसे 4-5 बार हो जाने के बाद वो ऑटोमेटिकली सीख जाती है, और हम उसको जो महिलाएं डिजिटलाइज ट्रांजेक्शन कर रही है उनको हम इंसेंटिवाइज करके जो इंटरेस्ट रेट हमने दिया है उसमें 2% उसको कम कर रहे हैं, तो ऑटोमेटिकली वो मोटिवेट होके डिजिटलाइज ट्रांजेक्शन कर रही है।
अभिषेक जी आप म्यूट पे हैं। सॉरी, धन्यवाद रेखा जी इन प्रतिक्रियाओं के लिए। कुसुम जी नहीं है उनके जगह पे, महेश जी हमारे साथ जुड़े हैं। महेश जी आपकी कोई राय इस बारे में ऑडियंस का, ये सवाल?
या हाय अभिषेक, हेलो एवरीवन। Actually, I just would like to put it here, like as Rekha ji said, rightly, the pandemic, the only positive we found in pandemic was the digital payments. Almost 65% SHGs has started paying their loans digitally in this COVID period. The reason was like, I mean, the branches are not nearby to the village or something like that. So it was difficult for SHG members or maybe loan bearers to reach the branches and do the transaction. Because even in branches, the people were not allowed to visit the officers and all that. So almost 65% SHGs has been making the payment, and we are thinking like by this year end, 100% SHG should make the digital payments. And of course, just a discussion maybe hamara aaya tha ki people are using Google Pay or maybe Paytm kind of things to just transfer. Maybe unke paas khud ke paas nahi ho, but ghar mein kisi na kisi ke paas to definitely hota hai. So that definitely helps to transfer the funds to their loan accounts. So ye ek cheez hai. Aur dusri baat aise hai ki we have tied up with Oxygen ATMs where basically our CRPs or maybe Sahyoginis are having those machines, and even some entrepreneurs also are taking those Oxygen ATMs, and those women are actually going into the villages so that debit or credit jo bhi ho wo machine ke through chalta rehta hai. So even in the pandemic people were getting the money through her, and even she is having some kind of business. At least I will say almost 2500 to 3000 rupees she was earning per month just because of this kind of transaction, and she was following all the COVID norms and all that. So these are the two digitization things Mavim did in last 1 year, and of course our motto is to reach 100% digital payments in maybe next 1 year or so. So that's it from Mavim's end. Yeah,
that's a great lofty target. Thank you so much for sharing that, Mahesh. I think we are already overboard with the time, but if our esteemed panelists allow, can we take another question? I think this one is for Bala. Bala, would you be okay with taking one last question from the audience? This question essentially, Bala, is with respect to training. Again, I think something that you briefly touched upon from a phygital model perspective. The question is, while providing these trainings to women, do you continue to provide with someone on ground as a supervisor that the participant can fall back on in case they are facing any issues in understanding the material or in terms of actually accessing that material that you've provided through the online e-learning module? So is there, what kind of an on-ground support do you have with respect to someone that they can reach out to for any issues in accessing that training material?
Yeah, no, there is, I think, as I mentioned, the last mile, the delivery person, which we call in our the enterprise model is that ABAs, Agribusiness Accelerator. And we have next layer, we have Activator. Their thing is that they have to meet these entrepreneurs regularly and look at how they have been actually implementing it. That's a follow-up happens on month-on-month basis with these communities to ensure that whatever we have been training, how they are able to adopt and where are the challenges. And that also feeds back to also improve our own, like the training methodology and then refinement in the content as well. That's a process we are adopting currently.
Thank you for that, Bala. I think we're running out of time. I'll quickly probably summarize the conversation so far and draw on the key takeaways that assist us as program partners in moving ahead. Priya, can you stay on the previous slide, please? Yes. Essentially, with respect to the first important takeaway from this conversation with respect to outcomes and outputs, I think it's very clear that the outcomes in terms of revenue increase cannot be estimated with reliable any degree of certainty to be achieved over a program period. And therefore, it's best to measure the outputs. These outputs could be with respect to those matrices that we had already indicated. I think there's a feedback around also ensuring that in some way portfolio performance is also an output which is used to incentivize. The second key learning that we are drawing around the cost and delivery of capacity building with respect to the work that Bala has been doing as well as Marvim has been doing is a focus on capacity building towards digital enablement and delivering these training modules as standardized curriculum through e-learning modules assisted with on-ground support and the indicative costs around that that need to be factored in from a service provider's costing perspective. The third key takeaway that I note from this conversation is that with respect to channelizing monies to the service provider or to the FIs, one key way to look at it is enlisting the support of the CLFs and leveraging the local cooperative banks in facilitating some of these transactions and deals, channelizing of money from donor agencies to these institutions or for-profit FIs may not be such a huge challenge and can be worked around on basis suitable legal inputs in the light of recent changes. Those are some of the broader takeaways that I can summarize at this point in time. I would also like to, as a last call for action from this group, seek a validation or seek a commitment or a support in terms of possibility to meet at regular intervals this joint expert committee, which can then take these discussions and negotiations further so that we can move towards closure towards implementation in discussions with other partners who might want to come in and venture in. As the last sort of a call from our side, looking to develop and stitch this partnership together, we look at your support to allow us to come back to you incrementally as we take these feedbacks on board to refine these structures and to take into account any counsel or any input that you provide towards final negotiation and discussion with the partners. I hope that's a commitment that I can take or I can presume from all of you, and I'm just jumping the gun on this. this has been a wonderful conversation. Thanks to all of you for devoting your precious time. Thank you to our audience members for being a patient listeners and for sharing their perspectives over comments in the comments box. Thank you, everyone. Any last words from any of our speakers? Happy to sort of pass the baton on to you. Otherwise, we'll call this session to a close.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Rekha ji. Thank you, Raman. Thanks. Thank you. Thank you, Bala.
Thank you. Thank you, Abhishek.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.